Hare Krishna. So today we are discussing on the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4. We are discussing the Pruthu Maharaj pastime, Canto 4, and this is text 31. So I will use this text to speak on a theme. The text is of how devotion is like a good habit and how it is more than a good habit. So, yat pad seva bhiruchis tapasvinam ashish janmopachitam malam dhiyaha sadhyakshinoti anvaham edati sati yatha padanugusht vinishtu saharet. So, the example is given of how the Ganga, just as the Ganga cleanses those who bathe in it, similarly, bhakti cleanses those who cleanses the hearts of those who practice bhakti. So, I'll focus on the theme here of how does bhakti cleanse our heart. So, I will speak on this topic of firstly, how devotion is like a good habit. Then second, how devotion is more than a good habit. And how, thirdly, how we can use the knowledge of how a habit works to practice devotion. And how we need to go beyond the understanding of how habit works to practice devotion. So let's begin. The first point is that devotion is like a good habit. So basically, this is a question that often comes up, especially in outreach to new people. They say that, okay, you say devotion transforms people. But then there are so many other techniques that also transform people. Some people practice mindfulness, some people practice vipassana, some people do so many other things, and they also feel benefited by that. They also feel transformed by that. Hare Krishna, is there a disturbance? Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear us.
Okay.
Please hit the phone, then
Hare Krishna. So devotion, so what is the difference between the two? If other things can also sometimes help people to give up bad habits, help people to control anger, help people to relieve stress, and we say devotion can also do all this. So devotion, so if can somebody say that I'm practicing some good habits and they also have the same effect as devotion? So what is the difference? So see, we are integrated beings presently. There's the body, the mind and the soul. And the body and mind are largely creatures of habit. And when we are practicing devotion with our body and mind, then naturally the mechanics of how the body and mind works will also work with respect to devotion. So basically, how does a habit work? We can say that a habit is formed when there is a particular action which we do, and if we do it repeatedly, if we do the action repeatedly, then that action forms an impression within our mind. And an impression comes up as a proposition. Proposition, do it again. And if we say, Hare Krishna. Yes.
Prabhuji, your voice is very low. We are not able to hear.
Okay. Is it better? Is it better now?
Yes.
Now is it better? Is it better now? Okay. Okay, thank you. So, I was talking about how devotion works like a habit because we are practicing devotion with our body and mind. And the body and mind are basically creatures of habit. So, any habit, how it works is there is action, there is an impression within the mind, and then that impression comes as a proposition to do the same thing again. So if somebody takes alcohol, say let's consider how a bad habit is formed, then that alcohol they drink once, twice, thrice. Each time they drink, next time the prompting to drink becomes stronger because that impression is stored in the mind and that impression comes up as a proposition. So here we could conceive of the mind like a software program where our choices are recorded as preferences, like a browser where we visit a particular site that's stored in the preferences. And then it comes back again as a choice. So if somebody say repeatedly visits some site like sports.com and then they come to a spiritual program and then they want to watch something spiritual and they want to search for spirituality.com, but as soon as they type SP, immediately sports.com comes up because that's what has been stored in the preferences. So similarly for us, habits are formed by these three things: action, impression, proposition. And when this becomes faster and faster, so when a habit is deep rooted, that means the action and the proposition comes so forcefully, so swiftly, that we don't even think about resisting it. We just do it. So now, is devotion also like a habit? Say, for example, somebody is addicted to television or net surfing. And then they decide that, oh, okay, this is wasting a lot of my time. So somebody is facing a lot of time on Facebook. Now, Facebook is the refuge of people who refuse to face books. Students who don't want to study just spend a lot of time on Facebook, say. Now, if you decide that, okay, they don't want to spend time on Facebook, they want to face books, they want to study. They start making a habit of studying and maybe they give up Facebook by that or decrease their infatuation with it. So they had in their mind, there was an impression of whenever they have some spare time, let's go to Facebook. But now they formed another habit. They maybe do it once, twice. Psychologists say that if you do anything repeatedly for 21 days, it becomes like a habit. Of course, the strength of the habit may vary, but if you just repeat it again and again and again, then that forms an impression. And that impression will come up as a proposition. So this is how people, by repeatedly doing something, can form a habit about that thing. And in devotion also, we do things repeatedly. So is it that, okay, every day, say we chant the holy names or we study Shastra or we do our puja, and by that becomes a habit. And that's what bhakti is. Bhakti is just another good habit. Now, of course, some people may say it is not even a good habit. Some people may say that you're wasting time. So that's, of course, materialistic or atheistic people will say that. But generally, cultured people will recognize that, okay, it's good that you do this. But is it just a good habit? So this part was, in bhakti, the activities that we do resemble the way we might cultivate a good habit. Wake up in the morning every day. Okay, cultivate a habit and that becomes habitual. And we start doing it. So bhakti does have a lot of actions in it which we do repeatedly. And that's how they become a habit. So when this happens, when bhakti becomes a habit, at that time, we might say that this is nothing more than a good habit. So it is a habit, but it is more than a habit. Why? Because devotion is an impression from outside that activates an inclination from inside. Say somebody in India was a cricket fan, and they come to America, and America, everybody is, say, baseball fans, and the student in college gets affected by the environment and becomes a baseball fan. So is it simply like that? Okay, we were in the association of materialistic people and we were materialists. We came in the association of devotees and we became devotees. So it's not just like that. Because if we consider internally the soul, the spiritual essence of who we are, it has nothing to do either with cricket or with baseball. Both are results of impressions formed by association, by the external situation, by the external actions. that we are doing or are exposed to actions of others, and then those impressions lead to propositions. And the same person who might have been a passionate cricket fan in India becomes a passionate baseball fan in America. So this is how one's habits may change. I'm using the word habit in a very generic sense to refer to any behavior that is repeated and spontaneous for us. So devotion is an impression from outside. When we go to the temple, we get an impression from outside. We chant, we're holding the beads in our hands. It's an impression from outside. But the difference is the devotion is also an inclination from inside. An inclination because devotion is connected with the soul. Devotion is the potential of the soul. The soul has an innate potential to love Krishna. Now, Prabhupada quoted the verse that Nitya Siddha Krishna Prem Sadhya Kabunai Shravanadi Shuddha Chitte Karaya Udai. So now different commentators in the tradition have explained this verse differently. So when Prabhupada uses the word that love for Krishna is dormant in the heart of all living beings. And if there is a hearing and an association, Shravanadi Shuddha Chitte Karaya Udai. Now, translations sometimes make things a little fuzzy, because there are many things which are spoken in a particular way in a language, and in another language that sense may not come out. Now, when we use the word dormancy, like somebody is asleep and they wake up. So that means the full energy to think, to act, to analyze that is there, but it's just inactive. That's the sense of dormancy. Now, Krishna Prem is not dormant in that sense. See, dormancy is full capacity is there, it's just not active. But then if you see the overall metaphor is of a Bhakti Lata Beej in the Bhagavatam. And Bhakti Lata Beej means that one is actually there's a creeper of devotion, and it initially the seed, and the seed grows. It has to be protected, it has to be nourished, and eventually it grows into a tree which gives the fruits of love of God. So here if we see the seed, is the seed a dormant fruit? Well, you could say that, but a more precise way might be that in English, if you want to word it, that a seed has the potentiality of the fruit within it, and this potentiality has to be developed. So devotion is similarly a potential of the soul, that every soul has the potential to love Krishna. And now you cannot say that every soul has the potential to love cricket or baseball or anything like that. It has got nothing to do with it. So with respect to any worldly thing, it is the outer situation that activates the outer perception or the stimulation comes from outside. The stimulation creates an impression, and that impression prompts an action. But devotion goes right to the soul. So it's an outer inclination an outer impression that activates an inner inclination. Devotion is something which the soul is innate potential for. And thus, devotion goes beyond the mechanics of how the body and mind works. Because devotion activates the soul. It triggers that soul's latent potential for spiritual perception, for spiritual realization. And that's how devotion is more than a good habit. So when we consider that, how does devotion purify the heart? The verse here says that the devotion purifies the heart. And the example is that Ganga cleanses those who bathe in it. So is devotion like an external flow? And the external flow cleanses whatever dirt is in our heart. Yes, it is like that, but it is more than that. It is more than just an external flow cleansing our heart of the dirt there. It is an external flow that actually, just like water can at one level clean the dirt, from any area. But if that area the soil is fertile and there are seeds sown over there, then growth of a particular thing will be there. But if the soil is not fertile and if there are no seeds over there, then nothing will grow over there. Even if there is cleaning of the surface, if the soil is not fertile, growth may not happen. Of growth, say if we want a mango to grow over there. Now, if the soil is not conducive of growing mangoes, we could say, oh, there is so much dirt over here, mangoes can't grow over here. Well, even if you remove the dirt, still mangoes will not grow because the soil is not fertile. So basically, devotion is more than a habit, because more than a good habit, because any habit will go to the level of the body and the mind. But devotion goes to the level of the soul and activates the dormant potential of the soul to turn toward Krishna. And so, yes, as far as stress relief is concerned, as far as de-addiction is concerned, as far as peace of mind is concerned, sometimes other habits may also provide that. Other activities may also provide that. The scriptures don't say that devotion is the sole way to peace of mind, or devotion is the sole way to give up bad habits. It is ultimately, peace of mind doesn't come just by having a peaceful mind. Peace of mind comes by having faith in Krishna and by turning our heart and soul toward Krishna. And yes, purification is one particular bad habit we might give up, but still the fundamental bad habit for the soul is that the soul is attached to material things, and that is going to cause disaster at the time of death, immense distress. So we need to consider that devotion works also at a spiritual level. So that was the second point. The first point was how devotion is like a habit, either external impressions which lead to propositions to repeat. But how devotion is more than a good habit, that is, devotion activates the soul's potential for loving Krishna. So it's an outer impression that activates an inner potential, an inner inclination. Then the third point will be, so how devotion works like a habit, or rather, when we are practicing devotion, there is the knowledge of habits that we can use, and there's the knowledge that it is more than a habit also we can use. So when we are practicing bhakti, if we try to develop see devotion as cultivating a good habit, then we see this mood, nashta prayeshu abhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavati ruttama shloke bhaktir bhavati naishtiki. So here the idea is said that nityam bhagavata sevaya. So nitya is talking about regularity, it is talking about habit. Study, serve the bhagavata, is seva, it is not even study the bhagavata. It is not adhyayan, it is not even pathan, it is sevaya. Yes, we want to study, but we study not in the mood of conquering the Bhagavatam with our intelligence, but we study in the mood of serving the Bhagavatam with our intelligence. So it is regular service. So by regular service to the Bhagavatam, we will get purified, we will get cleansed. And with Bhagavatir uttama shloke bhaktir bhavati naishtiki, bhakti will arise. So if we repeatedly expose ourselves to devotional impressions, by such exposure to devotional impressions, we will move closer and closer to Krishna till we eventually attain Krishna. That means we become completely absorbed in Him. That's one level. So whenever we want to practice bhakti, say if we want to make the habit of studying Shastra regularly, then we just decide, okay, I'll read one verse every day. Just to make it a habit, one verse, how much time it might take, just 5 minutes. Okay, let me do it for 5 minutes. Of course, we want to do more, we can do more. But the point here is regularity. Whether it is we read daily, whether we read weekly for a fixed number of hours, whatever it is. If we do it regularly, it will become a habit. So when something becomes a habit, we just start doing it. We just make time for it. So the power of the habit propels us. Now, I have been writing on the Bhagavad-Gita daily now for about 8 years. Since 2011 I started. So Gita Daily, I have been writing, and somehow, although I travel, I have sometimes a lot of programs, a lot of hectic things, but I spend about an hour or so to write every day on the Gita. That becomes like a class I am giving every day. It's a writing class. Actually, written classes are very different from spoken classes. In a spoken class, the speaker speaks for 1 hour and the audience hears for 1 hour. In a written class, the speaker or the author writes for 1 hour and the reader reads in 2 minutes or 3 minutes. So it's the amount of effort which is put in for the speaker, the author is much greater, and the amount from the reader is much lesser. It is said that what is written without effort is read without pleasure. If the author doesn't put in that effort, then the reader doesn't enjoy it, reader doesn't even understand it. It is read without pleasure. Anyway, the point I am making here is that I have been able to do regularly. Now, there are many other books I want to write. Okay, is it better now? I'm holding it right in front of my mouth. Okay, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Much better.
Okay, thank you. So now, but there's some other writing that I'm trying to do. There are books I want to write, but because there's no habit of that, so whenever I get time, I do it. Sometimes I'm able to do, sometimes I'm not able to do. So that which has become habitual, no matter how busy I am, somehow I'm able to make time for it. But that which is not habitual, my other writing, that is not happening because the power of habit is not supporting me. I'm trying to work on it. So recently I decided that I'll write 6 minutes every day. Now why 6 minutes? Sometimes the mind may say 6 minutes is not enough. You will not be able to write anything in 6 minutes. So 6 minutes is not so large that I have to think, oh, what am I going to write? I don't have to split. I can always have some idea that I can write for 6 minutes. And 6 minutes is not so small that nothing can be written. So I found that if I just write 6 minutes every day, I'm able to write between 100 to 200 words. And that's of course very rough draft, but some idea is there. So that's a habit I'm trying to cultivate to do my other writing. So for all of us, the bhakti works as a habit. And if we make something as a habit, then that can be very powerful for us. So whether it is, say, we make a habit of going for a weekly program. Then on some weeks when we don't have a program, we feel as if something is missing in our life. It's become a habit, and it's good that it's a habit. So bhakti works like a habit, and if we don't feel like doing it, Prabhupada would also say, even if you don't feel like doing it, just do it. So because devotion is an emotion, we often think that I should feel like doing it. But sadhana bhakti means we don't feel our way to actions, we act our way to feelings. Feel our way to actions means I feel like doing this, so I'll do it. But act our way to feelings means I'll do this and the feeling will follow. So that is where we are actually tapping the dynamic power of habits. When Prabhupada says, even if you don't feel like dancing in Kirtan, just raise your hands, just sing, just dance, and gradually the feeling will come. So he's talking about tapping the power of habit over there. Just act your way to feelings. Now, apart from that, there is also a transcend. So when we are practicing bhakti, if we just do the things mechanically also, gradually purification will result. But I quoted this word nashta prayeshu. Now the word there is significant of prayeshu. It's praya means almost all, most of it. It's not all of it. So Jal and Prabhupada writes in the purport over there that even the mechanical engagement in the devotional activities of hearing and chanting will purify us. Just repeatedly, if we hear about Krishna, if we chant about Krishna, that will bring us to at least a significant level of goodness and towards a favorable inclination toward devotion. We see some pious people, they love to recite maybe Bhagavad-Gita verses, Vishnu Sahasranam, and that is just like a habit. They do it, then the rest of their life they may not be very devoted, but that's a habit, and they keep doing it, and that gives them some pleasure because they are now reaping the fruit of a good habit.
So for all of us, we can't tap the power of habit by just making it a regular discipline. But I'll do it no matter whether I feel like it or I don't feel like it. And gradually, the feeling will come. Gradually, it will become a habit. But bhakti is more than a habit. So while we are doing something repeatedly, we also need to know that there is the element of mercy over there, which is extremely important. So earlier, so I'm talking about this in two different ways. I talked about how at the level of we practicing bhakti with the body and the mind, bhakti is like any other habit. It's mechanical. You do action, it forms an impression. Impression gives a proposition, and the proposition leads to action. That action leads to an impression. Impression leads to proposition. Proposition leads to action. Repetition of the action. That's how habits are formed. That's how bhakti also works at the level of the body and the mind. But at the level of soul, something more is happening. So earlier I talked about the aspect of how the soul has a dormant potential for loving God, and that is activated by the practice of bhakti. So it's not just, you could say that if we consider the mind like a whiteboard. So on the mind something is written and we erase it and we write something else. It's not, the mind is not exactly like a whiteboard, because you cannot erase whatever is written on it. There's no eraser for the mind. But what can be done is you can overwrite it. So it's like if a wall is covered with graffiti, sometimes people may try to delete the graffiti, but it's too difficult, then they might just overpaint the wall. So the impressions that we form in the mind, they cannot be erased, they cannot be scratched out, but they can be overwritten. So the more we give devotional impressions, the more the older impressions go deep into the background. In some old houses, sometimes there are multiple layers of paint that have been done. So if you try to scratch out one paint, you find another layer of paint over there. Scratch out that paint, you might find traces, not all the paint, but traces of that paint. So like that, we can overwrite whatever material mundane overpaint, or overwrite whatever mundane impressions have been there with spiritual impressions. But bhakti is not just like that. At the level of spirituality, there is the soul and there is Krishna. So what does when we are practicing bhakti, at one level we are doing the mechanical activities for cultivating a good habit, but also at another level we are cultivating a personal relationship with Krishna. And that personal relationship with Krishna means that we are trying to please him, and if he is pleased, he can unleash his omnipotence. He is supremely merciful, and if his omnipotence is unleashed, then what happens? Then he can do things which within a moment that we can't do even in a lifetime. So basically, we have certain indulgences, we have certain things which we have done in the past, and those past habits, we often call them as conditionings. Those conditionings keep haunting us even now. So when those conditionings haunt us, they are like ghosts coming from the past. And they keep pushing us, do this, do this, do this. And we want to say no, but we are unable to say no. But what Krishna can do is, Krishna's personal intervention can, in one moment, just diffuse the force of the past conditioning. The conditioning might be there, but its force won't be there. That means, say, sometimes if we look at our temptations also, sometimes say we have eaten some meal, but then suddenly we get what is called a snack attack. We are attacked by the desire to have a snack. Now sometimes the snack attack is mild. I say, I don't want to eat, just forget it. But sometimes the snack attack is so strong that even if you're doing some work, we just become restless. No, get up and search for some food. I have to eat something right now. Now, sometimes this might be genuine hunger. Sometimes it might be pseudo hunger. Now, if it is pseudo hunger, then sometimes the strength of the snack attack is weak and can be resisted. Sometimes the attack of this strength of the snake attack is very strong. So similarly, we can say that for each one of us, the past conditionings attack us. Sometimes it's strong and sometimes it's weak. So what Krishna can do if his mercy intervenes is that the attack of the past conditionings can suddenly become weak. The impression won't get erased, but the proposition coming from the impression may not be very forceful. Although considering the maybe how long in the past we may indulge in it, that proposition could have been much more forceful, but by Krishna's mercy, it does not come to us with its full force. It just comes like a mild attack that can be resisted. And by Krishna's mercy, also what can happen is that the positive proposition comes to us with much greater force. So the positive proposition means that, say, we start developing a habit, we start trying to develop a habit of studying Shastra, and suddenly we get a taste for it. And now we might be reading some other books, and we might generally be good readers. And whichever book we read, we develop a taste for that kind of reading, especially if it is good reading. But then suddenly we find that we get such an attraction for the Bhagavatam, for Bhagavad-Gita, for Shastra in general, that wow, it's a taste over there. As the Bhagavatam said, yadrasam rutyuptasya nanyatrasyadrati kvachet. So if we get taste for the Bhagavatam, then that taste is so overpowering that there is no other taste that allures us after that. So yad rasamrit truptasya. So by Krishna's mercy, when we are trying to cultivate good habits, he can increase the force of the proposition for that good habit much, much more than what it would be if it were simply by mechanical repetition. And thus, bhakti works like a good habit, but it works like much more than a good habit, because it involves attracting and activating the mercy of Krishna. And because this mercy, now how important is mercy, how important is endeavor? You could say in terms of we taking responsibility, we can work as if 99% of it is our endeavor and 1% is mercy. It's like when Mother Yashoda was trying to tie Krishna. Well, she was putting in her whole effort. So as far as trying to develop bhakti habits, we can treat bhakti like a habit and do our best to develop the bhakti habits. So in terms of our endeavor, we see it like we don't, if we think, oh, some people say, oh, when I feel attraction to Krishna, when Krishna gives me that taste, then I will chant. Well, Krishna is waiting us to pass his test. The test is, are we serious? Are we sincere? Are we practicing bhakti for our pleasure or his pleasure? So if we are waiting for taste and we say, only when I get taste, I will chant, that means we have already failed Krishna's test. The test is that we practice bhakti selflessly. That means even if I don't get taste, still I'll practice. So if we think like that, oh, when I get the taste, I will do bhakti. That's a little too... that shows we are not serious about our devotion. So in terms of seriousness of devotion means, we try to cultivate the bhakti habits as seriously as possible. And we don't demand grace. We don't demand Krishna's intervention in terms of sudden revelation of taste or sudden decrease of conditioning. But we keep doing according to our capacity. But in terms of the results, we know that Krishna can act magically and transform things. And that's why I met so many people across the world who said that when they started practicing bhakti, just yesterday I met someone, he said that he had been trying to give up smoking for a long time. Western person, and he said his health was being threatened because of his smoking. And he was trying for 15 years, he couldn't give it up. And when started practicing bhakti, in just 15 days, he just gave it up and never got the desire again. So we all have probably experienced some conditioning which just fell away so effortlessly by the practice of bhakti. And there are some conditioning which are not falling away, which are making us fall away again and again, at least fall down, if not fall away. Fall down means we can't follow the standards. Fall away means we just give up trying to follow the standards. We give up bhakti itself. So we may fall down because of our past conditionings, but we don't have to fall away because of them. We fall away when we give up the attempt to try to cultivate good habits. We fall down when occasionally our bad habits overcome us. But the point I'm making here is that we all have experienced how bhakti does work much better than any other strategy we might have used to give up bad habit, because Krishna's mercy is involved over there. However, Krishna's mercy is causeless. Causeless means that the cause is too less for the effect. It doesn't mean there is no cause. Our endeavor is a cause, but it is not the complete cause. We endeavor, but Krishna is not obligated to respond to our endeavor. And what Krishna gives in mercy, it is too big as a reciprocation for the thing that we are doing. That means it's causeless doesn't mean that there is no cause. It means that the cause is not the sole cause of the effect. The cause is only a tiny part. Prabhupada used the example for this that this happened on the morning walk, that a person is feeding ducks. Prabhupada saw that. And there's one duck was quacking very loudly. And as it's quacking loudly, the man was giving more crumbs to that duck. So Prabhupada said that this is how mercy works. If we endeavor more, if we call out to Krishna more, Krishna will give us more mercy. Now the man is not obligated to give to feed a duck more just because it is quacking more. The quacking is not the cause of the food being received. But the quacking than others is a part of the cause. It's that person's choice, that person's compassion, that they are giving more. So bhakti is like a habit, but bhakti is more than a habit. The more than a habit part is not in our control. That is mercy, and that we leave it to Krishna. But the habit part is in our control, and we do that to our capacity. And if we understand this, we do the mechanical part and leave the personal part to Krishna, we'll find that bhakti will transform our lives. Sometimes gradually, subtly, sometimes dramatically and hugely. But consistently, we will be on the path of purification and transformation, culminating in spontaneous, wholehearted attraction to Krishna. So I'll summarize. I spoke on the topic of how devotion is like a habit and is more than a habit. So some people may say that the same positive transformation that come by devotion can come by other methods also. So is devotion just like another good habit? We discussed in four parts. First is, devotion is like a good habit because we are practicing devotion through our body and mind, and the body and mind function in particular ways. So essentially how a habit is formed is four steps: action, impression, proposition, and repetition. We do something that creates, we visit a particular website that is stored in our browser history, and then next time when we type any letters corresponding to that, we type SP. If you visit sports and we type SP, even if you want to go to spirituality, sports comes up. So proposition comes up, and then the action is repeated by that. We might go to sports again. So this applies for good things and bad things. So in that sense, the body and mind are value neutral. Whatever we expose to it, it will start getting impressed and repeating it. So in this sense, devotion and so bhakti works like a habit, in the sense that we try to cultivate good habits. We try to go in association, we try to do our japa, we try to do our puja, we try to do our swadhyaya. We try to cultivate habits for this. But bhakti is more than a good habit because it is going to activate the soul. The soul has a dormant, soul has a potential to love Krishna. Just like the ground has the fertility, the soil has the fertility to raise crops. So the soul doesn't have any dormant, any latent potential to say love cricket or to love workouts or to love anything else. But so devotion is an outer impression that activates an inner inclination. So the external activities of devotion they gradually activate the soul. And that's why devotion is much more than a good habit. It is, it's not like, if there's graffiti on a wall, we can't erase it. So similarly, our mind is like a wall with graffiti. We can't erase the impressions, but we can overpaint it. But bhakti is like a overpaint that actually, suppose some wall is made of some very sophisticated technology that, you know, when a particular material is applied on it, from inside also, the wall starts giving out something which cleanses it. So it's like that. It's an outer cleanser and which activates the inner cleanser. And that's how bhakti works, much more than a habit. And then I talked about how when we are practicing bhakti, we can keep both things in mind. That we try to cultivate the habit of devotion. That means instead of feeling our way to action, that means, oh, today I feel like chanting, so I'll chant. I don't feel, I won't. We act our way to feelings. That means we do the action and gradually the feeling will come. So that is the essence of sadhana bhakti. We don't rely on our emotion, but rather we just cultivate the habit, cultivate the action. And that's what nashtra prayeshu abhadreshu. Just vanityam bhagavata sevaya. We serve the bhagavatam regularly, and by that, attraction to Krishna and elimination of anarthas will start happening. But then bhakti works like a good habit, it works like something more also. Why? Because when we do something good, that action gets impressed and a proposition comes. And something which you might have done earlier, that proposition goes in the background. But when Krishna's mercy intervenes, he can suddenly decrease the force of the past proposition. And that's why people who struggle to give up a particular habit before they started practicing bhakti, after practicing bhakti, suddenly give up that habit easily, within a few days. So, and Krishna can also reveal taste by which the positive proposition starts coming with much greater force. And that's what we call as taste in bhakti. Now, when we are practicing bhakti, we treat bhakti like a habit, in the sense that we don't leave it to just our feelings. We do it diligently. So while doing it, we consider 99% of it is my habit and my doing it. 1% is mercy. But in terms of the result, the transformation that will happen, our endeavor might just be like 1% and Krishna's mercy might be like 99%. The duck's quacking is not the cause of the man giving the food. It's independent but related. So the bhakti is causeless in the sense that the cause is too less for the result of bhakti. But when we understand both of these, so some days if we practice bhakti almost mechanically, doing it as a habit, that will also purify us gradually. And some days Krishna's mercy is revealed in our life and we experience dramatic transformation. And gradually or rapidly, we will keep moving onward toward Krishna if we understand the dynamics of how bhakti works. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Are there any questions or comments?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Thank you so much for the wonderful class, Prabhuji. Very nice points and instructions. I request all the devotees, if they have any questions or comments, Prabhuji, they can go ahead.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. There was at one point in your talk where I couldn't hear so well, but it sounded like you were trying to make a distinction between potential of the soul and the seed.
Yeah, potential and dormancy. Yes.
Can you repeat that?
Yes, definitely. So what is the difference between potential and dormancy? Basically, if a person is sleeping, we say they are dormant. That means their intelligence, their energy, their maturity, it's all there. It's just inactive right now. That is dormancy. Everything is there, it's just inactive. Whereas potential means, say for example, a seed of a mango has the potential for a mango fruit. Now, it's not that the whole mango is already there. The potential for it is there. And many external ingredients are required. The passage of time is required. And careful cultivation is required. So, if we see, so you could say, potential and dormancy are somewhat similar, but dormancy simply means like one switch. It's off, it becomes on, and it's fully there. But potential means it's systematic cultivation. It's, that's why devotion is conscious, continuous cultivation. And we see that's the mood in the metaphor of the Bhakti Lata peach, the creeper of devotional service. There is a seed which has to be consciously and continuously cultivated till the fruit of love of God can be relished. So that's the difference between dormancy and potentiality. So I made that difference because there are some traditional Gaudiya devotees who say that this idea that love for Krishna is dormant in the heart, that is not what scripture says. It's not love for Krishna is not dormant, love for Krishna has to be developed. So the point I was making is that it's true, both are true. When Prabhupada uses the word dormancy, Prabhupada uses dormancy in the sense of potentiality. In Nectar of Devotion, Prabhupada gives the example that say a child already has the potential to walk, but the parents need to train the child and the child learns to walk. So Prabhupada uses the word dormancy, he uses it in the sense of potentiality. Okay.
Yes, that's a very beautiful clarification. So thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
So Prabhu, you talked about developing that habit and you gave that example like reading just one shloka. Or translation maybe in a day. I know like a few years back I developed that habit, like I was so encouraged to see that Gita daily and I was thinking like I will read this at least every day I will read that and for maybe 1 or 2 years I did that and after that I don't know what happened. And there are so many things to read and then that habit just went away. So, Prabhu, what went wrong
there?
Okay, so now if we had some habit of, say, regularly reading Shastra, reading something based on Shastra, but then we, after doing it for 1 or 2 years, we lose that habit. So what went wrong? Generally, yes. Every habit needs to be nourished. And sometimes we might find that a particular habit, that there are broadly three possibilities with respect to a habit. That when we are cultivating a habit, we do it and it goes on lifelong. That's one way. The other way is we have a particular habit and after some time we start feeling that, I'm not getting much out of this habit. That means that, okay, I'm putting in some effort, but what are the returns I'm getting? The returns may not be much. And that's why we may feel it's not worth it. The third could be that we may take the returns for granted. That is, this is there, I can do it anytime. And then we don't value the habit or what the habit is giving us. And then we lose the habit. So that means we do a particular habit and it gives us something valuable and then we value the habit also. The second is we do a habit, but it doesn't give us something valuable and that's why we stop valuing it. That's why we stop doing it. Third is that we do a habit, it gives us something of value, but we stop valuing it and then we give up the habit. So we have to see for ourselves which category particular thing is in. As all of us are individuals and all of us are inspired by things according to our individuality. So, and what inspires us may also change over time. So maybe at a particular phase in our life, we are very inspired to study the Bhagavad-Gita. Maybe a few years down the line, we might be inspired by Bhagavatam, maybe by CC, Chaitanya Charan. But then later on, we might feel, oh, I thought I knew the Bhagavad Gita. I don't know it. Made me feel inspired that way. So we also have to see the bigger picture of where we are. And if we have a habit, it's good to take periodic stock and see whether we are getting something out of the habit. And if you are getting it, then to remind ourselves of that. Sometimes, you know, our good habits, they become a part of our culture, and that is good. But then our culture is so much a part of us that we are not even aware of it. Our culture is almost like our blood. The only time we notice our blood is when we start losing it. When blood starts sipping, dripping out from some wound, falling out of a wound, hey, what happened? So like that, our culture, we start noticing it only when we start losing it. So just like say, many Indians, when they come to America, and they may not be very religious or spiritual or anything like that, but after they get married, settle down, then they start becoming more concerned. Oh, our children are not getting our culture. We need to pass it on. So when they see that, oh, this culture is getting lost, not in their own actions, but in the probable actions of their children, that's when they notice it. So quite often for us, even when we have good habits, if we don't remind ourselves of the value of those good habits, then gradually we start losing those habits. And then sometimes we get a sudden reminder, oh, hey, why I was doing this, what happened, why did I give it up? So you know, usually, unless there is something, like say in the case of Ajamil, a fall happened very suddenly. But many of us, we have good habits, and sometimes the loss of those good habits is not a sudden deprivation, but a subtle diminution. So in slowly, 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 it just goes down. So it's very rare that Maya acts in a way that she tells us, you know, you're practicing Krishna Bhakti, just give it up. So that can happen sometimes when some very gross and very powerful temptation comes in our life. But usually Maya acts more subtly, by simply changing our priorities. That means if Krishna was number one or number two priority, Maya says, make it three, make it four, make it five. And then Krishna becomes our 100th or 10,000th priority after some time. So we have to see what has happened in our particular case. And then if we take periodic stock of them, and if they are good habits worth cultivating, then we value them. We remind ourselves of their value. Then we will not lose them without even realizing that we are losing them. Does it answer your question?
Yes, yes, Prabhu. Thank you. Thank you. Very nice explanation, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, thank you. Any one last question?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Koti Koti Nandas. My name is Srila Prabhupada Vijay Saravad. Thank you very much for your help. Prabhuji, my mother is staying with my two brothers. They are all prominent ones. So Prabhuji, now she is staying with me from last 9 months, and she is passing last stage of the material life. So sometimes I will continue the small box of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, and sometimes I continue the Swamnayan Maha Mantra. Is it right or is it wrong? Because she is following the different point.
Okay. So if your mother is, she has been following a different path, and now she is in the last stages. So sometimes you put the Maha Mantra, sometimes you put some other mantra. What is
they must keep following.
Is that the right thing? See, in relationships like this, the right thing has to be determined just by exploration. There is no absolute right thing. In the sense that it's not a matter of just philosophical correctness. It's a matter of personal acceptance and personal effectiveness. Every soul has free will, and we have to respect their emotions, their choices. And there are different ways of looking at this. if she can hear the Hare Krishna Mahamantra more and more, that is best. It is Krishna who is being remembered, and it is Krishna who has the potency to purify. No, but this is a whole different class about when people worship something else or someone else or whatever. See, there are, within the practice of bhakti, there are three aspects. What are within the practice of religion, you could say, not just bhakti, you know, it is what we do, with what conception we do, and how we do it. So, you know, some people might just do some Sai Kirtan, and they chant, and they seem to be in ecstasy. Just chanting the names of some names which are not even mentioned in scripture, as far as the authorized scriptures go. So now what is happening over here? Actually, it is, to some extent, our minds are very powerful. And the emotion of our mind can also create a certain experience for us. So if somebody is worshipping a particular, say, God-man or particular teacher, and they consider that teacher to be divine, now their emotion also creates their experience, apart from whatever is the philosophical reality creating that experience. Yes. So our minds are very powerful, and just like if we imagine the food that we want to eat, that will also cause our tongue to water. And then that food is right in front of us, that will also cause our tongue to water. So even when somebody is worshipping someone who is not the supreme, but if they have the mood of devotion, the mind has the power to create that emotion. Now that emotion, in terms of their experience, it is real. But in terms of elevating the consciousness to transcendence, because that emotion is not triggered by a transcendental stimulus, it will not have that effect. That is not something which is experienced immediately. That difference is not something which is experienced immediately, however. That's why I said, you know, what we do with what conception we do, all that is also important. So if somebody is habituated to chanting or hearing a mantra of a particular teacher, then if that is what has given them peace of mind previously, then suddenly stopping that might cause a lot of agitation for them. And if that is going to happen, then it's better that we, because at that time, we don't want to entirely disrespect their wishes also. So, we might put the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, but if they are habituated to something else and they feel agitated because we are not giving them that and we are imposing our faith on them, then that agitation, that resentment will block them from even receiving the Hare Krishna Mahamantra gracefully. And ultimately, Krishna wants us to go back to Him. Krishna wants us to, if not go to Him, at least go closer to Him. But that is when we want to go closer to Him. It is bhajatam priti purvakam. It is with affection. It is not bhajatam, say, ghrana purvakam. That's not really devotion. So we have to respect their wishes. And if sometimes they're getting some experience of peace by that, then that's okay. What you're doing is fine. Sometimes Hare Krishna Mahamantra, sometimes some other mantra. If they don't mind it, then having the Hare Krishna Mahamantra is better. But it's not that. The key thing is that we have to respect what their choice is and what it is that they want to experience. We can't just impose what we are doing in the name of that this is the reality and that is not. We have to be sensitive. Does it answer your question?
Yes, Prabhuji. My mother is 85 years old and she lost her memory. She is an anxiety patient. And Prabhuji, she loved to hear L.G. Lal Govind Prabhuji's class every day, 5 to 6 hours in our language, Gujarati language. And from childhood, we worship Dattu Gopal, Vallabhacharya
Pandit. Oh, okay.
So she is also singing Hare Krishna Mahamantra. But I feel bad, that's why I am keeping her Mahamantra and my Mahamantra together. She is happily singing Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Mantra. Pray for her. She's suffering a lot from last 2 months.
Hare Krishna, best wishes and prayers.
Yes, Prabhuji, your answer is it's a really work, Prabhuji. Dandavat Pranam, Hare Krishna. Koti Koti Dandavat Pranam.
Dandavat. So, shall we stop here?
Yes, Prabhuji.
So, thank you very much.
There are no more questions. We can stop the call.
Thank you very much, Granthraj, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.